Hey y'all, thanks for tuning back into Chickanic. Up, everybody's having a great week. Now I got a weird one for you today, and it's not one that you'll see all the time, but if you do have these models, it definitely could be an issue that you have in the future. So I want to save you some time, money, and frustration. So watch this video to find out what could possibly be wrong with your Stihl BG56 blower. But before we jump into today's video, if you're a fan of saving time, money, and frustration while fixing your own small engine equipment while watching in-depth tutorials, you've come to the right place because that's what I do. I upload a couple times a week, and if that sounds interesting, hit that like button, smash that subscribe, don't forget to hit the notification bell, and please leave a comment. I love to read through the comments, and I will reply to all the early commenters. Now, this issue isn't necessarily brand specific. I see this in lots of other things. Most of the time in blowers, doesn't matter if it's a backpack or a handheld, but the Stihl BG56, I happen to see this quite often, a lot more than I do in other stuff. They also make a backpack blower. They're one of their smallest ones, which is actually like this size engine, might be the same exact engine, just with some straps on it. So hopefully, if you have this issue, I'm gonna show you how to fix it. So first thing we're gonna do, let's take it outside and see what it's doing. So when the customer brought it in, they said that it just stopped pulling, that they couldn't get the pull rope to come out. So I'm going to try to start it. I've got it turned on, going to prime it. It's not really priming. Let's make sure there's some gas in it. Check this out. So, looking inside here, there's like just a tiny little drip of gas. Where'd all the gas go? Not in the gas tank. So if there's no gas in the gas tank, it's gotta be somewhere else, or the customer completely forgot to put any in, which I doubt because he's sort of semi-commercial and I don't see him doing that. So let's try to pull it and see what he was talking about. Oh yeah. Well, something is definitely wrong with it. I don't think it's the rewind assembly, but let's go inside and pull the plug and see what's up. So I got the plug out. It is very wet and exactly what I suspected. Let me show you. Okay, for this, I pulled out my Endoscope, my bad boy one. I will leave a link in the description box below to this one. And then also there's a cheaper one you can get that I used to use. It's pretty awesome too. But if you do not have an Endoscope, they are just super cool to play with. I'm gonna show you the inside of this cylinder and show you what's going on. Also, I had some people ask about the tachometer that I've used in my past videos. Any tool that you see me use when it comes to my hemostats, my toolkit, anything that, you know, my spark tester, I have a list complete of all the tools that I use in the description box below this video. Okay, so let's see if I can get in here and show you what's going on. I'm gonna stick the camera down in here. And that's the top of the piston, okay? And I wanna be able to show you, I'm gonna shake it back and forth. That is gasoline. All that stuff you see floating around in there, this thing is completely flooded. That, it's not flooded, it is engulfed with gasoline inside of it. So the needle obviously didn't shut off. I see this a lot whenever it's warm outside, especially since it's been in the mid 90s here in Arkansas. It happens more frequently. The expansion from the gas in the tank, if it doesn't have, you know, a way to release, it just goes through the carburetor into your cylinder and fills it up. And then that's the reason that we can't pull the pull rope. It's too much pressure inside there. So I'm gonna take it outside, turn it on its side, pull the pull rope a few times and get all that gasoline out of there. This is the easiest way to do it for me. I'm going to got the spark plug out, turn it on its side here and pull it. Wow, that's a lot of gas. I'm gonna go into the carburetor and see what's going on. Like on all Stihls, you're gonna wanna break out your T27 torque, and it has three screws holding the rewind on and three screws holding the side of the handle on that we're gonna wanna take off so we can get to everything really easy. Before I jump into this, I do want to give a shout out to somebody because I really, really owe a lot of what's been going on in my channel to this person. If you do not follow the Mower Medic, Jeremy has had his channel for years and has tons of content. When I first started my channel and started actually continuously making videos, he reached out to me and sort of, you know, told me a little bit about the ropes, introduced me to some other people and, you know, part of the small engine community, and was extremely helpful and has been very, very kind-hearted and constantly looking out for me on anything and giving me, you know, hints and tricks about YouTube. So he is at, I think, 98,700 subscribers today. He is only 1,300 subscribers away from reaching 100,000. So for me, for him, if you have not gone over to the Mower Medic's channel yet and subscribed, I promise you, if you have a question about anything, anytime that I needed to know some weird steel thing, I'm not a steel dealer, so I don't get to go to steel technical school. So if I needed to know something about a steel, since he's so knowledgeable about it, I went to his channel and there was, you know, the answer for me there. So I would like you, if you have time, go check his channel out, give him a subscription, and get him over the top of 100,000. That would be awesome. Now let's tear this apart. Now for this particular blower, you only have three screws, one, two, three. On some of the other handheld blowers, they'll have another one right up here. And then there's three screws holding this side of the handle on. We're gonna wanna remove that so it's easier to get our carburetor off because the throttle lever is attached to this trigger. Now when you take your screws out, be aware of where each screw went in. The three screws that went into the rewind, they go into metal, so they have more of a fine thread on them. The ones that go into the plastic handle have more of a, you know, thicker, coarse thread to them. So make sure that the ones that go in the metal don't go back in the handle, because you will strip them out. Now that I got the rewind assembly off, I'm gonna pull it a couple times. Yeah, it's fine. We definitely know it was the issue with the cylinder and the gasoline. All right, go ahead and take our air filter. We didn't even have an air filter in there. People, air filters, gotta have them. Going to take our nuts off of our air filter base and get this carburetor off. All right, so I've got everything cleaned up. It was super nasty. It seems to collect a lot of debris in this area usually. I did blow out the tank vent really well because that could have been the culprit that, you know, made all this flood into the cylinder like it did. So let's go ahead and take the carburetor off and check this needle out. So I went ahead and removed the throttle lever and trigger out of the way. It has two nuts holding the air filter base on. I'm gonna use my 8mm nut driver to remove those. And if you wanna get your own like mine, the WERA, I do have a link in the description box below so you can get your own. So. Next, you're gonna wanna remove the fuel lines. Now there's a plastic insert going in through a grommet into the tank, and that's where I like to remove them from. That way they can stay on the carburetor sometimes, and that way you know which way they go back easiest. Then we can go ahead and remove the carburetor. Now, we have the carburetor off, so we might as well check inside and see what's going on. But the culprit might definitely be that tank vent clogged up. That will, you know, not let it release the pressure that it needs to and push straight on through the carburetor. But we do want to double check this needle, the diaphragms in here, make sure that they're not hard and that that's the issue. So first I'm going to go ahead and check my metering diaphragm side. And that still feels really good, yeah. I don't know if I can get where you can see it, but you can also see it's still pumping. See the gas coming out both sides. Hopefully you can see that. So I think the diaphragm is still actually really good. I'm just gonna go ahead and check the other side, just make sure everything's good in that side. I don't wanna take the gasket out if I don't have to. If it's good, I mean, the customer's gonna have to pay for a carburetor kit that they don't need. Because I'm thinking it might be that tank vent. Oh, that sort of sucked in. I don't know if you can see that very well. See how bad it's sucked into this metal piece? It definitely needs to be changed. The screen seems okay. So we might as well go ahead and pull this side and put a carburetor kit in. Let's take that off. Hopefully this gasket comes off in one piece. No, it said no, I'm not gonna do it. Oh, maybe some of it, and it's ripping to nothing. So we gotta get it off. Not too much on there. I can get that out of there. Okay, that's pretty good there. A little bit more. Now for this side, it's so much easier when it comes off in one piece. Sometimes it's stuck like Chuck. I've seen fuel additives that can destroy the gaskets and diaphragms and just cement them inside of these carburetors. We got half of it up. So close, almost all of it. Alright, we just got a little bit right here we're gonna get rid of. And a little over here. Now, the one thing that's no fun about these is you've got to find a really dinky little torque to get this screw out right here. We have to have a T9 to get this little tiny screw out here. Why they put a Torx screw in here, I don't know, but somebody got paid big money for that. So I do have my Owl Tool 6-inch Torx bit set. It's awesome. There is a link in the description box below if you want to get your own. The 9 fits in there just perfect. I use this for my WERA set because I usually use this with my drill, and I'm not doing that on this carburetor, so we're just going to unscrew that needle right out of there. Set that to the side. Everything falls out. I'm going to grab my adjusting tool so I can take my high and low jets out. Bust out my tool kit here. Comes with tons of adjusting tools. And get yours now. Whenever I started telling people about these, they were only $7 and some change, and now they're past $10. So you're going to want to get them quick because everything's just going up. We got the hexagon. And first thing we're going to do, we're going to see this is the high over here and this is the low. So before we come out, we're going to want to go in and see how many it is inward. Wait a minute. Well, after further inspection, looks like the customer or somebody they took it to tried to adjust the carburetor with the wrong tool. What happens when you probably only had the Poulan spline tool and you tried to adjust a hex head? You destroy the tops of the heads of your high and low needles. So I have nothing to grab onto to remove them. So I guess I'm just gonna throw a kit back in here, not clean through the high and low, hope they're adjusted correctly, and see what happens. Wow, great. So I guess this is a perfect time to remind you, I have a link in the description box below if you would like to get your own toolkit for $10 that pretty much covers every 2-cycle and 4-cycle trimmer, blower, whatever you've got. So get one of these and don't destroy your high and low needle. So I went ahead and gave it a good spray anyways. I went in through the needles, sprayed out the screen real well because the only kit I had in stock right now was a rotary one. This does take a Zama kit RB155, but the Zama aftermarket kit that I had, I do not like this big honky screen that it comes with. So a lot of times I just clean out the one that it came with. I also do not like this little needle lever. It feels a little janky to me. So I just go ahead and use the old one and make sure that it's still in good, you know, condition. But the needle, the gaskets, and the diaphragms are always fine. So I'm gonna go ahead and throw these in there and let's put it back together. New needle in. And this gets easier the more you do it. Set the spring in, set the needle in, have it to where it's, you know, sticking farther out on one side, this little rod here, than it is on the other for where it would be in the carburetor. I just come straight down on the spring and swoop under the needle, just like that. Once you got it in, hold it all with your finger and we'll put our screw back in with our T9. Do not wrench that in hard. You're just going to make sure that it's seated well. I'm gonna check my little lever here. Looks good to me. Next, the gasket always goes first. A lot of people get these confused and they'll put their metering diaphragm first and then the gasket. Gasket always goes first. Then we put our diaphragm. Now, this one, it was sort of hard because it's got a hole on each side, so you might not know, but you do know from if you leave your fuel lines on this way that one of your fuel lines was coming off this way and one of them was going off this way whenever you took it all apart. So you know that this top piece goes this way since they were opposite of each other. Just lining my bolt holes up here. There we go. Set it right on top. Get these in here. Do not ever crunch it either. Like if you feel some resistance as you're putting these screws in, make sure to go back and come, you know, go back in because you can catch your meter and diaphragm and destroy it if you don't have things lined up correctly. And I guess that's all we can do. Now, one more thing I do want to do before I start putting everything back together is I want to go ahead and remove the muffler. It's not that big of a deal just to take it off real quick, just two bolts holding it on. That way I can make sure that it is not full to the max of gasoline like everything else was, because everything sort of does go down in this direction. And even though we did get it out of the cylinder and the carburetor is not flooded and I'm going to make sure that the tank vent is not going to be an issue, it could still be full of gasoline in the muffler and just keep continuously flooding as you're trying to start it. So we just want to make sure that that is not an issue. Was full of gasoline. Okay. All right, so I got a puddle under there, but trying to get the rest of it out here. This would have definitely been an issue if we would have tried to start it. So it would not have started. It would have just continuously kept flooding out. So if you have an air, compressed air, you might want to blow through it, but I think that's pretty good. I think we got it mostly all out. Now we're ready to put everything back together. I think we're good to go. I'm gonna put the muffler on first. We can go ahead and put our carburetor back on. The throttle lever side goes towards this part and the adjusting side goes out. So I'll just slide it back on there. Then I'm gonna reattach my two fuel lines. Now when we put our trigger and our lever back in, one side is like a perfect 90. The other side is 90, but then it's got sort of a squiggle to it, like that little curve. That's the side that goes in the carburetor. So we're gonna grab it here, see if I can do this while looking at the camera, while making sure. And we go on the inside between the carburetor and this lever right here, and we're gonna go into the hole from the inside. Just like that. And this can just set up here, and that's what's gonna go into our throttle trigger. So we got this little rod here that our trigger goes on. It goes up like that. Then we're gonna put this part right into this hole, and that's good. We can put our side cover back on our handle. Next, we'll put our air filter base gasket back on and our air filter base and replace the nuts that hold it on. Now, his plug was pretty gross, so I'm gonna go ahead and throw him a brand new plug in there. Now I'm gonna go ahead and throw some fuel in it. We're gonna see if it starts up and maybe the carburetor's adjusted correctly. Let's hope. But the only way I can check it next to see if it's going to happen again is to let it sit. But fortunately, since I know that that was an issue, instead of it sitting how it does normally with everything going towards the cylinder and piston and flooding that out in the muffler, I'm gonna leave it at an incline going this way. That way it can come out the air filter, and I'm not gonna put the air filter or the cover on there. That way I can watch it and see if anything comes out. That way I know it's still flooding, and I might go for that tank vent next. I'm not sure. Maybe it was just the heat. I have no idea. That could definitely be it. You leave these in a hot truck, in the bed of your truck with 100-degree, you know, beaten sun on it, it will expand the tank and it will flood through into your piston and cylinder or wherever it can get out of. It will come out your air filter or something, and that might be why the air filter wasn't on there. It might have been soaked. Obviously, somebody tried to adjust on it thinking that was the issue. That was not. It's almost dark outside, but we're going to see what it does anyways. Giving it a prime. Prime and good. I better not choke it. Of gas. So before I go to adjusting on it, because I can just boost the throttle up a little bit, give it a little bit more air so it can stay idling, but I'm going to run it at high just a little longer to make sure that it's not still flooded a little bit. Gasoline in there, so thankfully we don't even have to adjust it. Awesome. Well, it ran, so that's potential right there. I will keep an eye on it and, you know, leave it at that tilt so I can see if it leaks out the air filter assembly, and that way I know if it's still going to be an issue or not. But like I said, it could have just been a fluke. The needle could have just not shut that one time. Could have been the heat, could have been a weird part of gas, could have been the choke left on, could have been a lot of things. but hopefully this video will save you time, money, and frustration in the future. Also, please don't forget, if you would like to, go over to my buddy, the Mower Medic on YouTube and check his channel out if you have not subscribed yet. He's only 1,300 subscribers away from 100,000. I cannot thank him enough for all the support he's given me over this last year, and I just want to return the favor because he is an awesome dude. So thanks again for tuning in to Chickanic. If you haven't found us on Facebook, find us at facebook.com/Chickanic. Find us on Instagram at TheRealChickanic, or find me at Chickanic.com, where you get your own hoodies, t-shirts, or long sleeve shirts. Thanks, and have a great day.